وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَن سَبِيلِهِ ذَلِكُمْ وَصَّاكُمْ بِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ.
الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abundantly the way He deserves to be praised. We ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace and send His salutations and blessings upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Al-Aqidatul Wasatiyah welcomes you to this class, and I welcome you as well. We are embarking on a great, great, great journey. Bismillah. The journey of Ayatul Kursi. And what do you know about Ayatul Kursi? Well, it doesn't matter, because even if you didn't know anything, once we're done with this topic, you will know a lot, inshallah. So we stopped at the statement of the author or the sharih, Shaykh bin Uthameen, rahimahullah, qawl al-mu'allif, حيث يقول الله لا إله إلا هو. في هذه الآية يخبر الله بأنه المنفرد بالألوهية وذلك من قوله لا إله إلا هو، لأن هذه جملة تفيد الحصر، وطريقة النفي والإثبات هذه من أقوى صيغ الحصر. طيب، what does all that mean? The Shaykh says, as for the statement, Allah, there is no deity worthy of worship except He. This ayah informs us about singling Allah in divinity. It informs us about Allah's right of being worshipped alone. And وَذَلِكَ مِنْ قَوْلِهِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ لِأَنَّ هَذِهِ جُمْلَةٌ تُفِيدُ الْحَصْرِ. This type of sentence suggests exclusivity. It suggests exclusivity. And the method of negation and affirmation, this method of negation and affirmation is among the strongest methods of suggesting a form of restriction or exclusivity. So when you say, Allahu la ilaha illahu, Allah, there is no deity worthy of worship except He. This method of negating and affirming is among the strongest expressions of exclusivity in the Arabic language, affirming the meaning that this belongs only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tamam? وقوله الحي القيوم الحي أي ذو الحياة الكاملة المتضمنة لجميع صفات الكمال لم تسبق بعدم ولا يلحقها زوال ولا يعتريها نقص بوجه من الوجوه. As for the statement, الحي القيوم, الحي is the one who possesses the perfect life, which covers all of the other attributes of perfection. And one of the important things is that it has not been preceded with non-existence, nor would it be coming, nor would it be followed by any form of extinction. Rather, it is perfect in every respect, and there's absolutely no deficiency in any way, shape, or form regarding it. There's no access to any imperfection. So it is that perfect life. And the life of Allah, unlike our lives, is that Allah's life was not preceded by non-existence, and it will not be followed by extinction when something goes extinct. So that is very important for us to pay attention to. وَالْحَيْ مِنْ أَسْمَاءِ اللَّهِ وَقَدْ تُطْلَقْ عَلَىٰ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ. Al-Hay is one of the names of Allah, but it can also be given to other than Allah. قَالَ تَعَالَىٰ يُخْرِجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ. Allah says He brings forth the living from the dead. وَلَكِنْ لَيْسَ الْحَيْ كَالْحَيْ. However, one type of aspect or one type of a living is not exactly similar to another type. Meaning, just because they're both called al-hayy, it doesn't mean that they're identical. ولا يلزم من الاشتراك في الاسم التماثل في المسمى. And the fact that there's a commonality in the word or in the name does not mean that the essence is also similar. And that's very important. The fact that two things may share a name does not necessitate that they will share the same essence and attributes. And we could give hundreds of examples from our worldly life to the same effect. For instance, you could have a car. A car is a generic name. And we know that there's a Porsche, and then there's a Toyota. And while they're both cars, they're sharing the name, they ultimately do not share the essence and the attribute. القيوم على وزن فيعول وهذه من صيغ المبالغة. As for قيوم, then it has a form of فيعول, and that is one of the methods of exaggeration or hyperbole. وهي مأخوذة من القيام, and it is derived from the word قيام. What is قيام? Does anyone know? الرجال قوامون على النساء. What is قيام? قيام, and we also know it as praying at night for some people, but in this context, قيام is to maintain. Is to maintain. ومعنى القيوم أي أنه القائم بنفسه. The meaning of قيوم is that Allah Azza wa Jal is self-maintained. فقيامه بنفسه يستلزم استغناءه عن كل شيء. The fact that Allah Azza wa Jal maintains himself necessitates that he is in no need of everything else. He is free from needing anything else. لا يحتاج إلى أكل ولا شرب ولا غيرها. Allah Azza wa Jal is in no need of food or drink or anything else. وغيره لا يقوم بنفسه. However, anything other than Allah cannot self-maintain itself. بل هو محتاج إلى الله عز وجل في إيجاده وإعداده وإمداده. Rather, that thing which exists besides Allah is in need of Allah for its mere existence, for its growth, and for its provision. And that is beautiful when you think about it. If you pause and think about it, and we discussed this in the last class, that shows you the greatness of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that shows you the weakness of anything and everything besides Allah. And that's also under the meaning of the word samad. Remember we said samad? Huh? Samad, we called it, one of the words we use in English is absolute, meaning, يعني الذي يعتمد عليه كل شيء, the one whom upon everything relies. وهو لا يعتمد على أحد, and Allah Azza wa Jal does not rely upon anyone. Now we talk about the word qayyum, you see a similarity in the concept. Allah does not need anyone and anybody, and everything else needs Allah. Whether it is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whether it is the angel Jibreel or Mikael or Israfil or Malakul Maut or al-Malaika bishakil aam wal-Anbiya wal-Rusul wal-Bashar wal-Hayawanat wal-Shams wal-Qamar, kullun bihaja ila Allah. Everything and everyone is in need of Allah, and Allah is in need of no one. وَمِنْ مَعْنَى الْقَيُّومِ كَذَلِكَ أَنَّهُ قَائِمٌ عَلَى غَيْرِهِ لِقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى أَفَمَنْ هُوَ قَائِمٌ عَلَى كُلِّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ. One of the meanings of قَيُّوم is that Allah Azza wa Jal also maintains others. Allah says in the Quran, is then he who maintains every soul with what it earns? وَالْمُقَابِلْ مَحْذُوفِ تَقْدِيرُهُ كَمَنْ لَيْسَ كَذَلِكَ. And the sentence has some omission in it. Something is omitted, and it is understood by the context, meaning he is not like the one who is in need of someone else. Is the one who is maintaining others like the one who needs to be maintained, basically? وَالْقَائِمُ عَلَى كُلِّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ هُوَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. So who is the one who maintains everything, every soul in what it earns? It is Allah Azza wa Jal. وَلِهَذَا يَقُولُ الْعُلَمَاءُ القيوم هو القائم بنفسه القائم على غيره. So the scholars say القيوم is the one who maintains himself, the one who is maintaining himself, and the one who is maintaining others as well. قال الله تعالى ومن آياته أن تقوم السماء والأرض بأمره. And from among his ayat and his signs is that the heavens and the earth are maintained by his command. فَهُوَ إِذَنْ كَامِلُ الصِّفَاتِ وَكَامِلُ الْمُلْكِ وَالْأَفْعَالِ So Allah Azza wa Jal then is perfect in his attributes and perfect in his sovereignty and in his actions. الله أكبر الله أكبر وهذان الاسمان هما الاسم الأعظم الذي إذا دعي الله به أجاب ولهذا ينبغي للإنسان في دعائه أن يتوسل به فيقول يا حي يا قيوم الله أكبر time out because this is deep my brothers and sisters the Sheikh said Those two names are the greatest names of Allah. They are the most magnificent names of Allah, which if you were to call upon Him by these names, He will respond to you. That is why it is incumbent on a person to beg Allah and beseech Allah through these names. Ironically, we're speaking about tawassul, which is a form of intercession. And we just uploaded an old lecture, which I delivered many years ago by Allah's grace and mercy, about the concept of tawassul. And actually, in the lecture, we discussed one of the lawful and prescribed and beloved means of seeking nearness to Allah and making dua is doing tawassul through your deeds or tawassul through Allah's names and attributes. And this is one of them. So you beseech and you beg Allah and you seek intercession from Allah via those two names. So you should say often, Ya Hayyu, Ya Qayyum. Of course, not like the Sufis. How does the Sufis do it? The Sufis, they all gather together in a room and they, you know, they bring a bunch of break dancers and some, you know, really artistic that, hey, 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 who, 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 who. حي يا حي يا حي يا قيوم طيب إيش إيش تبغى What do you want Imagine you go يعني معلش with the vastness and difference but I just want to bring the point home You go into the office of your boss huh and his name is George and you're like George 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 By the time you're done George has already taken off his shoe and already put it right through your forehead Or George is already signing the paper of firing you with no end of services and making sure you go to prison for 16 years before you get deported from the country. No one in his right mind is going to go stand there and repeat the name of the whoever he it is that he's asking for things from. And if this is the case with the creation of Allah, nobody will be, what is the point of a people say Allah, 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 Allah like the Sufis do? It's ludicrous, Ya Akhwan. It's ludicrous. And that's how you learn this religion of Allah. What did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam do? How did he remember Allah? They were all meaningful sentences, meaningful words. Subhanallah. Glory be to Allah. Alhamdulillah. All praises due to Allah. Allahu Akbar. Allah is the greatest. It's a meaningful expression. But repeating the name of Allah endlessly is not. Saying who, which is supposed to be Allahu la ilaha illa hu. So they pick on the who and they keep repeating it. And this is very common in the Muslim world, among the Sufis. And that's why when you learn, you will realize, okay, when you say ya hayu ya qayyum, then you make your dua, ya hayu ya qayyum irhamni, ya hayu ya qayyum ihdini, ya hayu ya qayyum irzuqni. You ask Allah Azza wa Jal for something after you mention Allah's name. You don't just mention Allah's name endlessly without any benefit behind it. وَقَدْ ذُكِرَ فِي الْكِتَابِ الْعَزِيزِ فِي ثَلَاثَةِ مَوَاضِعِ Those two names have been mentioned, have appeared in the book of Allah in three distinct occasions. In three distinct occasions, Al-Hayy and Al-Qayyum came together. هَذَا أَحَدُهَا The first one is in Ayat Al-Kursi. والثاني في سورة آل عمران. The second one in سورة آل عمران. الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم. الله عز وجل. There's no إله except Him. الحي القيوم. والثالث في سورة طه. And the third one in سورة طه. وعنت الوجوه للحي القيوم. وقد خاب من حمل ظلما. And faces shall be humbled. before Al-Hayy and Al-Qayyum, and he will be a failure who carried wrongdoing. For example, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to say, Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum, bi rahmatika astaghith. Ya Sheikh Sa'id, atfi al-kamera, barakallah fiqh. Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum, bi rahmatika astaghith. O Hayy, O Qayyum, it is through your mercy, it's your mercy that I beseech. For your mercy, I beg. For your mercy, I beseech you. And so you see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam teaching the ummah, when you want to mention the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, then you follow that up, or you complete it, or you conclude it with an actual request and a dua, and not the mere repetition of the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب هذان الاسمان فيهما الكمال الذاتي والكمال السلطاني. Those two names contain self-perfection and sovereignty perfection. فالذاتي, as for the self-perfection, في قوله الحي, in the name of Allah, الحي, the ever-living. والسلطاني, and that of sovereignty from Sultan, في قوله القيوم, لأنه يقوم على كل شيء ويقوم به كل شيء. Because Allah عز وجل maintains everything, and everything is maintained by Him. وقوله لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم. As for the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, neither sleep nor slumber overtakes him. Overtake him, because it's actually both. Bismillah. والسنة النعاس. What is سنة? It is drowsiness. وهي مقدمة النوم. It is the introduction of sleep. وَلَمْ يَقُلْ لَا يَنَامْ لِأَنَّ النَّوْمَ يَكُونُ بِاخْتِيَارِ. Allah Azza wa Jal did not say that he does not sleep, because sleeping is a matter of choice. وَالْأَخْذُ يَكُونُ بِالْقَهْرِ. But it is to be, but and take, it's taken by, it's overtaken by power, by a form of coercion. وَالنَّوْمُ مِنْ صِفَاتِ النَّقْصِ. قَالَ النَّبِيُّ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنَامْ وَلَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَنْ يَنَامْ. Sleeping is one of the attributes of imperfection. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Allah does not sleep, and it does not befit him that he sleeps. وهذه صفة من صفات النفي وقد سبق أن صفات النفي لابد أن تتضمن ثبوتا وهو كمال الضد. And this is an attribute of negation, and we've already established that the attributes of negation will always contain an affirmation, and that is how perfection is attained. When you negate something, you're automatically proving the opposite of that, and that brings about perfection. وَالْكَمَالُ فِي قَوْلِهِ لَا تَأْخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ كَمَالُ الْحَيَاةِ وَالْقُيُومِيَّةِ. The perfection in the statement, he is not overtaken by slumber or sleep, is the perfection of Allah's life and maintenance, meaning His maintaining of others. لأنه من كمال حياته ألا يحتاج إلى النوم. Because one aspect of Allah's perfection in His life is that Allah Azza wa Jal is in no need of sleeping. So Allah's living, the quality of living, necessitates that He does not need any sleep. ومن كمال قيوميته أن لا ينام. And from the perfection of Allah being the maintainer is that He also does not sleep. لأن النوم إنما يحتاج إليه المخلوقات الحية. Because sleep is only needed by live creatures. Living creatures are the ones that are in need of sleep. لنقصها. Why? Because of the deficiency of the human beings, or the deficiency of the creation. لأنها تحتاج إلى النوم من أجل الاستراحة من تعب سبق واستعادة القوة لعمل مستقبل. Why do you need sleep? You need sleep in order to rest from a pre-existing fatigue, and in order to rejuvenate your strength for an upcoming futuristic action. وَلَمَّا كَانَ أَهْلُ الْجَنَّةِ كَامِلِ الْحَيَاةِ. And when because the people of Jannah will have the perfect hayat, كَانُوا لَا يَنَامُونَ كَمَا صَحَّتْ بِذَلِكَ الْأَثَارِ. They will not sleep as it has been authentically narrated. But I can imagine I can imagine some of the brothers and sisters who love sleep saying, but can I sleep in Jannah? I mean, okay, Allah said that we will not sleep. But I love sleep so much, I can just imagine myself wanting to sleep in Jannah. So can I still sleep? And there are a number of ways to answer this, this concern. The first of which is, first of all, go to Jannah. Huh? MashaAllah, and I love it when, yani, it's nice to be confident, but we need to slow the roll a little bit. Huh? First of all, let's make sure that we are on the path that will lead us to Jannah, bi-idhnillah. We assume good about Allah, but if you're a true believer, you always have to be worried. Only the hypocrite feels secure, and the believer is always worried and wary. So first of all, go to Jannah. Second of all, ya Sheikh, don't you know that Allah Azza wa Jal will, we will not enter Jannah until people are cleansed from everything that might bother them or any kind of preconceived notions they have? Meaning what you might think you want now, you will not want over there. What you think now you would want, once you're there, it's not even going to cross your mind. So if Allah said you don't sleep, I mean you don't sleep. Thirdly, it could be said that Allah Azza wa Jal says, لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا. They will have whatever they desire in it. So it could be that if a person really wanted to sleep, that Allah Azza wa Jal will allow them to sleep. But yeah, so you got to be careful. Somebody posted an interesting comment on this, but I can't remember right now. Anyways. طيب على كل حال لو كان لو لكن لو قال قائل النوم في الإنسان كمال ولهذا إذا لم ينم الإنسان عد مريضا. But if a person were to say in terms of human, for humans, sleeping is actually a form of perfection. In fact, if a person does not sleep, we consider him to be sick, right? And you know, what is it called? Insomnia. People that are that have insomnia are those who are unable to sleep at night. And of course, being the strange person that I am, a brother asked me, brother, how do I deal with insomnia? I said, sleep. He said, how? I said, usually it happens in bed. I think it was an effective advice. I hope he had good nights after that advice. فَنَقُولْ كَالْأَكْلِ فِي الْإِنسَانِ كَمَالْ وَلَوْ لَمْ يَأْكُلْ عُدَّ مَرِيضًا. We will answer that person by giving him an analogy. We say, look man, eating for a human being is also a form of perfection, because if a person were not to eat, he will also be considered to be sick. لَكِنْ هُوَ كَمَالٌ مِنْ وَجْهٍ وَنَقْصٌ مِنْ وَجْهٍ آخر. However, it is a form of perfection from one angle, but it's a form of deficiency and imperfection from another angle. Why do we say it's a form of perfection? Because it suggests that a person is healthy and that he's all right. But it's also a sign of deficiency because the body is in need of it. And therefore it is in reality a form of imperfection. وَإِذَنْ لَيْسَ كُلُّ كَمَالٍ نِسْبِي بِالنِّسْبَ لِلْمَخْلُوقِ يَكُونُ كَمَالًا الْخَالِقِ. Therefore, not every aspect of perfection in relation to the creation is also considered perfection for the Creator. كَمَا أَنَّهُ لَيْسَ كُلُّ كَمَالٍ فِي الْخَالِقِ يَكُونُ كَمَالًا فِي الْمَخْلُوقِ. Similarly, not every quality of perfection in the Creator is actually a quality of perfection in the creation. فَالتَّكَبُّرُ كَمَالٌ فِي الْخَالِقِ نَقْصٌ فِي الْمَخْلُوقِ. So arrogance or pride is a quality of perfection in the Creator, but it's a quality of imperfection in the creation. It's a quality of imperfection in the creation. So Allah Azza wa Jal, يعني he has the qualities, and part of that authority that he has, and part of being the Creator, necessitates that Allah Azza wa Jal has this form of pride that doesn't befit human beings, because we're just the creation. So that pride befits Allah, does not befit His creation. وَالْأَكْلُ وَالشُّرْبُ وَالنَّوْمُ كَمَالٌ فِي الْمَخْلُوقِ نَقْصٌ فِي الْخَالِقِ. And then similarly, or on the other hand, eating and drinking and sleeping are perfection for the creation, but a deficiency for the Creator. وَلِهَذَا قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْ نَفْسِهِ. That's what Allah said about Himself in the Qur'an. وَهُوَ يُطْعِمُ وَلَا يُطْعَمُ. And he is the one who feeds, but he is not fed.
وَقَوْلُهُ لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. لَهُ خَبَر مقدم.
Now we're going to get into some grammar. To him belongs what is in the heavens and what is in the earth. The Shaykh said, لَهُ خَبَر مُقَدَّم. It is the subject and predicate. It's a predicate of a sentence that has been put forward.
وَمَا مُبْتَدَى مُؤَخَّر.
And مَا is the subject that has been delayed.
فَفِي الْجُمْلَةِ حَصْرٌ.
This sentence is a form of exclusivity.
طَرِيقَةُ تَقْدِيمِ مَحَقَّ تَأْخِيرَ التَّأْخِيرَ
مَحَقَّهُ تَأْخِيرَ. And that happens by putting forward what should have been mentioned later.
وَهُوَ الْخَبَرَ. And that is the predicate.
We've discussed this in the past, by the way. So for example, if you say, I'm going to the market, okay? I'm going to the supermarket. We understand from this that you're going to go to the supermarket. And that you're probably going to go to other places as well. If you say, to the supermarket, I am going. It gives us the idea that you're exclusively going to go to the supermarket and you're not interested in going anywhere else. Now, I know it's not the same in the English language, but I'm trying to give you an idea of how it works. So whenever there's a subject and a predicate, and I hope you know English enough to know what subject and predicate is. If you don't, I don't know what you were doing in school when you was a little kid. Some of you still don't know nouns, pronouns, adverbs, adjectives, demonstrative pronouns, conjunctions, you know, all this type of stuff. I like English. I've always liked English. It's such a nice language. But nothing beats the Arabic type. Anyways, so subject and predicate, as you say, you know, whatever. Anyways, I'm not going to give you an English grammar lesson right now. What am I doing here?
المهم, اللام له, اللام هذه للملك, ملك, ملك تام.
له, the lamb here is one of ownership, meaning complete sovereignty.
بدون معارض, without any objection.
ما في السماوات من الملائكة والجنة وغير ذلك مما لا نعلمه. So everything in the heavens belong to him, from among the angels and Jannah and other things which we don't even know about.
وما في الأرض,
and whatever is upon the earth. من المخلوقات كلها, from among all of the creation.
الحيوان منها وغير الحيوان,
the animal and the other than the animal as well. So all of the creatures, all of the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وقوله السماوات تفيد أن السماوات عديدة
وهو كذلك. And the statement of Allah عز وجل, سماوات, heavens, suggests that the number of heavens are abundant. They are many.
وهو كذلك. And it is so.
وقد نص القرآن على أنها سبع. The Quran has explicitly said that it is seven. يا عبد الكريم, يا شيخ, يا أخوان, please turn off your cameras. The class is not for us to see you. It's for you to see the book, ya Mus'ab.
I can't turn it off.
Abdul Karim, akhi, stabbed us right in the heart. Ah, I'm alive. Type. The Quran has specifically mentioned that it is seven.
قُلْ مَنْ رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ السَّبْعِ وَرَبُّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ.
Allah says, who is the Lord of the seven heavens and the Lord of the magnificent throne? So Allah mentioned seven heavens.
وَالْأَرْضُونَ أَشَارَ الْقُرْآنَ إِلَىٰ أَنْ أَشَارَ الْقُرْآنُ إِلَىٰ أَنَّهَا سَبْعِ بِدُونَ تَصْرِيحِ وَصَرَّحَتْ بِهَا السُّنَّةِ.
And as for the earth, then it's also seven. The Quran indicates that it's seven without clearly explicitly stating it, but the Sunnah explicitly stated that there are seven.
قال الله تعالى, الله الذي خلق سبع سماوات ومن الأرض مثلهن.
Allah is the one who created the seven heavens and of the earth the like thereof.
مثلهن في العدد دون صفة,
meaning there are like them, meaning the earths are like the heavens in number, not in the quality.
وفي السنة قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام,
and as from the Sunnah, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said,
من اقتطع شبرا من الأرض ظلما طع طوقه الله به يوم القيامة من سبع أرضين. أوبا. Whoever acquires a space of land unjustly, Allah will encircle it to his neck on the day of judgment from the seven earths. And that's a very dangerous thing, ya akhwan, and that shows you the seriousness of taking and transgressing against people's properties and people's things. Some of us are very negligent. You'll be walking around, you know, in the street, you see some nice flowers or some garden that belongs to someone's house, and you help yourself to something and you pick out a few flowers or roses and you keep moving. Hello? Like, you can't do that. You cannot do that. You know, some people really transgress. Another common example, and sad as well, is the people's free usage of slippers in the masajid. Ya akhi, this is one of the most mind-blowing things in the history of the world. I think they should teach it in history, grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4. Historically, how in the world do you go to a masjid and then you see someone else's slippers, some other person's slippers? I'm not talking about the one that belonged to the masjid. Okay, there are some masajid that are kind enough to put those, which I will still never use because Allahu A'lam, what kind of foot was in it a minute earlier? I mean, come on, you should have some hygiene as a believer. Now, we Muslims are clean people. You don't just put your foot in any given shoe. But that's besides the point. People, they're not talking about the slippers that are like the public slippers. No, they actually take out someone else's slippers with their nasty feet and they put them on and they go to the bathroom and they make wudu. And then, you know, the person was wearing these Crocs, for example, they were dry. He comes out of the salah, his shoes have been used. And they're wet and they're stinky. I don't believe it. I don't believe it. Wallah, I don't believe it. How can you be so oppressive? What is wrong with you? Either you go prepared or you cannot go and use people's property like it's your father's. Look, ya Sheikh, if it was your father's, you're not allowed to use it. If it's your father's shoes, you cannot use it without his permission. And so when non-Muslims or reverts, when they first enter into Islam, those experiences will scar them for life. Those experiences will scar them for life. They will never get over it. Especially if they come from a background where they're clean, they're a decent family, they're well groomed, well dressed. They're a good Muslim family, but they're not Muslims. They behave like Muslims, and then us Muslims, you come into the house of a Muslim and you see it, you know, it's nasty and it's smelly, and people have, you know, long armpit hair that they don't shave. They smell from a distance, and you just, you know, hair disheveled, everything is all over the place. Why do we allow the teachings of Islam to be applied by non-Muslims, and us Muslims completely dismiss them and we don't even put them into practice? So, I mean, I know I want a tangent here, but I'm just saying. Y'all gotta stop doing this. Akhi, you cannot, the shoes area in the masjid should not be smelly. It should not smell. You should not be using other people's shoes. You should not be, if anything, use your own. Ruin your own shoes before you use someone else's without their permission. عيب والله عيب. طيب وقوله من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه. Huh. So now we're going to come into that. Who is that who can intercede before him except with this permission? من ذا اسم استفهام. This is an interrogative pronoun. أو نقول من اسم استفهام. وذا ملغات. ولا يصح أن تكون ذا اسما موصولا. Leave that. This is too grammatical. وَقَوْلُهُ مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ الشَّفَاعَةُ فِي اللُّغَةِ جَعْلُ الْوِتْرِ شَفْعًا. Very important. Who is it that he can intercede, who can intercede with him? The Shaykh said linguistically, الشَّفَاعَة, intercession, linguistically means to make that which is singular dual. It is to make that which is one into two. تمام? This is the meaning. قال تعالى والشفع والوتر. الله عز وجل said والشفع والوتر. So and basically, and the even and the odd. So it's either by doing it with numbers 1 and 2, or by saying it's to make that which is even odd. الشفاعه ان تشعل to make that which is odd even. I'm sorry, to make that which is odd even. حلو. وفي الاصطلاح and but legally in terms of our sharia, هي التوسط للغير بجلب منفعة أو دفع مضرة. Linguistically, or I'm sorry, legally, it is to intercede or to become a middleman for someone else in order to bring about some benefit for him or to remove some sort of harm. فمثلا شفاعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لأهل الموقف أن يقضى بينهم. An example is the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam on the day of standing, so that Allah Azza wa Jal will begin the judgment. Allah Azza wa Jal will begin the judgment. هذه شفاعة بدفع مضرة. This is the type of intercession where you are removing harm. وشفاعته لأهل الجنة أن يدخلوها بجلب منفعة. Whereas his intercession for the people of paradise to enter it is the type of intercession where you bring about a benefit. So شفاعة is your interference into with someone, for you to interfere in the case of someone, either to remove some harm from that person or to bring about a benefit. All right? In the case of the Prophet ﷺ, when he intercedes for the people, for Allah to begin the judgment, that's to remove a harm after they've been waiting for 50,000 years under the sun, which is only 1 mile away. And his intercession for the people to enter Jannah is the type of intercession where Allah Azza, where the Prophet ﷺ is bringing about a benefit to the people via that intercession. Of course, the source of the benefit is Allah Jalla Jalaluhu wa taqaddasat asma'uh. Wa qawluhu 'indahu ay 'inda Allah. Meaning with him, meaning with Allah. Illa bi idhnihi ay idhnahu lah, except with the permission of Allah to that person. Wa hadhihi tufidu ithbati ash-shafa'ah. This ayah confirms the affirmation of intercession. This ayah affirms the affirmation of intercession. لكن بشرط أن يؤذن. However, with the condition of permission. ووجه ذلك أنه لولا ثبوتها لكان الاستذان في قول إلا بإذن لغوا لا فائدة فيه. And the way we come around, come about the way we deduce this deduction, that it's affirmed, because if it wasn't, then this whole exception of except to this permission would have been idle, of no benefit. When Allah says, "Man dal ladhi yashfa'u," who will intercede with him? If it was there was no such thing as intercession, what would be the benefit of Allah saying except to this permission? It become useless. So the presence of except to this permission affirms the existence of intercession. Kapish? Inshallah. وذكرها بعد قوله له ما في السماوات. Allah عز وجل mentioned this after the statement, to him belongs what is in the heavens. يفيد أن هذا الملك الذي هو خاص بالله عز وجل أنه ملك تام السلطان. This proves and benefits us in a sense that this sovereignty that is exclusive to Allah is the ultimate type of sovereignty. بمعنى أنه لا أحد يستطيع أن يتصرف, which means no one is able to do anything, no one can interfere, no one can do any action, no one can make any statement. ولا بالشفاعة التي هي خير, not even with the intercession, which is a good thing. إلا بإذن الله, except with the permission of Allah. وهذا من تمام ربوبيته وسلطانه عز وجل. And this is a manifestation of the perfection of Allah's lordship and Allah's sovereignty, the sublime. وتفيد هذه الجملة أن لله إذنا. والإذن في الأصل الإعلام. And this sentence also, it benefits us that Allah عز وجل has a permission. And إذن linguistically means to notify, is to announce. قال الله تعالى وأذان من الله ورسوله, and a proclamation from Allah and His Messenger. Where is it? إعلام من الله ورسوله, meaning it's a proclamation, it's information, it's an announcement from Allah and His Messenger. فمعنى بإذن أي إعلامه بأنه راض بذلك. It is meaning Allah's proclamation that he is pleased with that intercession. وهناك شروط أخرى للشفاعة. There are other conditions for the validity of intercession. منها أن يكون راضيا عن الشافع وعن المشفوع له. Among them is that Allah عز وجل should be pleased with the intercessor and the one being interceded for. قال الله تعالى ولا يشفعون إلا لمن ارتضى. And they do not and they intercede not except for him whom he is pleased. وقال يومئذ لا تنفع الشفاعة إلا من أذن له الرحمن ورضي الله قولا. On that day intercession should not benefit except whom الرحمن permits for him and who's saying he is pleased with. وهنالك آية تنتظم الشروط الثلاثة. There's an ayah that actually elaborates or enumerates the three conditions. وكم من ملك في السماوات لا تغني شفاعتهم شيئا إلا من بعد أن يأذن الله لمن يشاء ويرضى. And how many angels are in the heavens whose intercession shall be of no avail except after Allah gives permission to whomever He wills and is pleased and is pleased. أن يرضى عن الشافع ومشفوع له. That Allah is pleased with the intercessor and the one being interceded for. لأن حذف المعمول يدل على العموم. Because when you don't mention the object of the sentence, this also suggests generality. إذا قال قائل ما فائدة الشفاعة إذا كان الله تعالى قد علم أن هذا المشفوع له ينجو. Ooh, very interesting question. If someone were to ask, what is the benefit of the intercession if, while we know that Allah already knew beforehand that the one who's being interceded for will make it? When we know that Allah already knows that that person will be saved, doesn't he? Doesn't Allah know the decree? Doesn't Allah know who's going to end up in Jannah, who's going to end up in hell? He does. If someone was about to end up in hell, then Allah allowed for the intercession to take place, and then via that intercession, that person now did not go to hell and went to paradise. Someone may ask, what's the point of all this? If Allah knew that at the end he's going to be saved, then what is the use of the intercession? فالجواب أن الله سبحانه وتعالى يأذن بالشفاعة لمن يشفع من أجل أن يكرمه وينال المقام المحمود. Allah allows this to happen, for this intercession to happen, so that Allah عز وجل will honor the person who intercede and so that he will have that praiseworthy status. وقوله يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم. العلم هو إدراك للشيء هو إدراك لشيء على ما هو عليه إدراكا جازما. علم is to know something the way it's supposed to be known in the most concise and perfect sense, like something that is clear cut. والله عز وجل يعلم ما بين أيديهم. Allah عز وجل knows what is between their hands, meaning the future, المستقبل. وما خلفهم. Allah knows what is behind them, meaning الماضي, the past. وكلمة ما من صيغة العموم. And ما, when it comes ما بين أيديهم, ما خلفهم, it's also a word that suggests generality and vastness. تشمل كل ماض وكل مستقبل. It encompasses every past and every future. وتشمل أيضا ما كان من فعله وما كان من أفعال الخلق. And it also encompasses what would be the actions of Allah and the actions of the creation. وقوله ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء. And they do not encompass him in any. They do not encompass any of his knowledge except with that which he wills. This, inshallah ta'ala, we will postpone the discussion on until next week. Bi'idhnillah azza wa jalla, if Allah keeps us alive and healthy. And with this, inshallah, we will conclude so we can open the Q&A and see what y'all have to say about what's going on right now. So we're going to stop sharing and turn into the many chats which were happening in the middle of the class, which is very surprising. Tayyib, a bunch of salams. Wa alaykum salam to all of you. Ahlan, 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 ahlan. Can you please suggest a good share of Aqidah al-Wasitiyah in English? Are you kidding me? What are we doing here? Ya Muhammad Arif, Ya Sheikh, my balcony is only on the first floor. Yani, you want me to break a leg? Allah knows everything, but being human beings, we have to do our part and work for it. Tayyib. Some people say that raising the hands during the takbira for the janazah prayer and the Eid prayer doesn't have a sahih dalil. What's mentioned about it? No, the scholars have differed on it. The scholars have differed, and there's plenty of dalil. It's a matter of ijtihad. Oops, I'm sorry, I'm shaking the whole thing. It's a matter of ijtihad among the scholars. And there's a fatwa on Islam QA that breaks it down, so check it out. Brother, please explain the concept of the seven earth and heavens in light of today's science. I don't care about today's science. I'm sorry. I don't care what science has to say. I believe in the Quran and the Sunnah. If the scientists find seven earths, congratulations. If they don't, they can keep searching. Best of luck. I have a question. I often heard the statement, we can different in fiqh as long as not in aqidah. Some rejected the advice because of this. Is this fine? Example, the sister doesn't want to recite Quran during tajweed class because she is on her menstruation. Okay. Also does not want to eat seafood because the mother said it's haram. She can if she's following. That's obviously the Hanafis. But just for the record, the Hanafis are, for the most part, in these aspects are off the Sunnah. And so it's not okay that you follow any madhab blindly. You should follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Regarding Jannah, where is it? Is it an authentic opinion that if a woman marries after she widowed and when they gather together in Jannah, she will be married to a last husband of this world? Yes, as far as I know, that is the case. Is it correct that the hadith of reading Surah Kahf on Friday isn't authentic? Some of the scholars say that it's authentic. I follow the opinion that the hadith regarding Surah Al-Kahf on Yawm Al-Jum'ah are authentic. Let us jump on this YouTube now that we're done with the Zoom. Oh, mashallah, there's nothing going on YouTube. That's what happens when we give you all the Zoom link. Huh? I thought we were friends. Now we got 11 people watching on YouTube and everybody's on Zoom. Good one, guys. Good one. Yalla, ma fi mushkila, as long as you're happy. Sir, is the hadith authentic, which is supposedly narrated from Ibn Abbas, that there are seven earths and there are seven, and that there are seven Ibn Abbas? No, there's only one Ibn Abbas. And we already mentioned the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salam. So whether that hadith of Ibn Abbas authentic or not, I don't know. But we already know that there are seven earths and seven heavens. So if you know, what's the deal? What would be the ruling in practicing the hadith that were known to be weak? You should stay away from weak narrations. Some of the scholars say if the narration is in the fada'il, if it's in the area of the virtuous acts of worship, and if it's supported, if it's not very weak, and it's supported by other hadith, that it's okay to work and apply it, provided that you mention that it is weak. That's one opinion. I personally follow the opinion that if it's a weak hadith, leave it altogether. You have plenty of authentic narrations to rely on, that you are in no need of having to refer to any weak hadith. Please explain the hadith that says some group of people will enter Jannah, their heart will be like the bird's heart. I'm not familiar with what you're saying. I've come across it. I skipped it. Yes, I skipped it because it's not the time to be discussing this brother right now. There's a lot to be said and it cannot be addressed. Whatever I say in a Q&A is not going to be sufficient to elaborate on the subject matter. So inshallah, maybe in another video, in a dedicated session, we can discuss those things during those times. Yeah, Mr. Saeed. But for now, I would say do not listen until further notice. Do not listen until further notice. Brother has a lot of good, but there are a lot of issues as well. And you have to be careful. It's not for everybody to be listening to these kind of arguments and debates about philosophical arguments and dealing with debates with atheists. I'm sorry, the debates with atheists. It's a very tricky subject. And you should stay away from it based on my previous advice that you shouldn't listen to debates. And most of the brothers' work is debates. May Allah reward them with goodness. But there are a lot of issues as well that the ulama warn against when it comes to ilm al-kalam. So you have to be wary. Hey. أهلاً وسهلاً. Yes, Umm Farooq, you're welcome. And I feel the same way. Because in so many ways, I am a revert. You know what I'm saying? I was a Buddhist, I came into Islam, and those things definitely have a negative impact. And of course, I've spoken to plenty of brothers and sisters who've, you know, expressed a similar concern. Wallah al-musta'an. Tayyib Habibi, shukran ya Saeed, I'm glad that you're satisfied with that. How do you balance between the deen and the dunya, especially in matters of earning rizq? By balancing between them. I'm so mean. I don't know what to tell you, bro. I just do it. I work and I give a class like I'm doing right now. I play sports and I sleep. I don't know. I don't know why people struggle with how do you do it. I feel like there's something like, how do you walk? By moving one leg forward and then following up with the other one. And if with constant motion, I wind up walking like that. I know this is annoying, but that's really how I see it. How do you balance? By just balancing. Allah facilitates, obviously. Your job is just to make an effort. Is it permissible to deny the parents when they don't allow you to do niqab? Okay, if you're of the opinion that niqab is obligatory because you understand it to be so, then you don't have to obey your parents regarding that. If you're wearing it just as a voluntary act of worship and your parents don't want you to wear it, then do not wear it. Is Hakim Archulita reliable? Who in the world is that? Okay, I'll check YouTube. I have no idea who that is, ya Elias. Hayallah Sheikh Elias. Assalamu alaikum, Ustadh. Question, what do you advise for someone to do for someone approaching death? What do you advise for someone to do for someone approaching death? What am I? Do you want me to, the person dying or a person who's close to the person dying? Please explain. Is there any book in English that talks about the preservation of the Quran? The translation of the Noble Quran. It's there in the Quran. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Verily, we have sent down the reminder and the dhikr and we will preserve it. The Quran already tells you. I know you mean something more than that, but I'm not familiar with it. I know Sheikh Abdurrahman Hassan gave a nice long talk about it. How did I join Samsung? I joined Samsung while doing Hajj. I was into telecommunication and I had some experience back in America. And I was a big tech smartphone guy. And I met the head of department on Hajj while giving a talk to the reverts about the dangers of Shia and cursing the Sahaba. And then he invited me to give a talk to his Korean colleagues who were non-Muslims, obviously. And then they found out that I'm quite skilled at knowing the smartphone, and I had the Note 1 back then, the first Note that Samsung ever launched. And it was like a perfect marriage between the groom and the bride. Obviously, I was the groom. And they were the bride. And yeah, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Should we take knowledge from Yasir Qadi? No, but you can take some time out from him for until he changes. Until then, no Yasir Qadi. Unless you want to become confused about your deen and doubt the Quran preservation, doubt which aqidah we follow, doubt whether you can celebrate birthdays or not, doubt whether the mawlid is bid'ah or not. If you want to doubt everything in Islam, Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Zainab bin Jahash, anything you want to doubt about Islam, Yasir Qadi is the ultimate source of doubt in the Ummah. He's currently offering doubt lessons and doubt courses, paid. They're not even free. Jazallah khair. And he actually gets paid for it in order to cast doubt into your mind. And he works close to Yaqeen Institute and he defends all of the Yaqeen guys. So that shows you the level of doubt is as high as it gets. May Allah Azza wa Jal guide him as soon as possible. What is the condition of the people who say they won't take a hadith which they think contradicts the Quran? Example, a hadith about the impermissible of speaking against the hukam in public. Well, we say to them that you follow a religion other than the religion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam taught us to follow the Quran and the Sunnah. Allah informed us to follow the Quran and the Sunnah. And the Quran and the Sunnah explain each other. And they may even abrogate one another. That's how authoritative the Sunnah is. So you say to that person, watch my lecture, the philosophers. Watch my lecture, the philosophers. Ustad, can I take the good from spubs and leave the bad? Yes. Yes, ya wacko bear. What kind of name is this, ya wacko bear? Yes, akhi, you can take the good from spubs and leave the bad. In fact, they have a lot of good. A lot of good, may Allah bless them, and some bad. So yeah, take the good, leave the bad. Salamu alaykum. Okay, bro. A grandparent is dying from cancer. What should one do during this time? One should be as kind as possible to that grandparent, spend as much time as possible with him or her. You know, show kindness, show love to them. You know, remind them of Allah Azza wa Jal, remind them to assume good about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, do as much good as you can for them. Do as much good as you can. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum salam. Ustad, do you deliver lectures at Jeddah Dawah Center or IMC Hospital? I deliver lectures at home. Neither at JDC nor at IMC. That was back in the day, and today is a new day. Have you ever heard of there being two Fir'aun? A friend told me in Yasir Tafsiri, he mentioned the Fir'aun during Musa's birth is different from the Fir'aun that was drowned, I guess. It shocked me because I never heard it. Well, of course, if you listen to Yasir Qadi, you will continue to get some really odd positions that are not mainstream Islam. But that's his job. His job is to do some research, find some odd opinion, unorthodox, and bring it to you, say, I hate to be the bearer of truth. In my humble opinion, all the scholars don't know what they're doing, but here I am, Yasir Qadi, the Sheikh al-Islam of my time, bringing it to you raw, just like you like it. Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan is a trustworthy scholar. Yeah, Sheikh, if Sheikh al-Fawzan is not a trustworthy scholar, who is? For sure. For sure, Sheikh Fawzan is a trustworthy scholar. Advise on the correct ruling on Isbal. I have a lecture titled Hell Equals Garment. Maybe someone can post it in the section in the whatchamacallit, the chat box. The whole lecture is about the subject. Brother, if you sin in public, is making tawbah enough or you have to publicize? If you sin in public, free mixing, is making tawbah enough or you have to publicize? No, of course making tawbah is enough. Why would you publicize? Why would you expose your sin? If Allah covered your sin, then be quiet. Be happy that Allah did not, you know, expose it. And if it becomes a need, then you may have to speak about it. Steps on how to relearn Islam when you were raised with a lot of misguidance by following One Way to Paradise, Al-Madrasa Al-Umariya, Abu Usama Al-Dhahabi, Brother Sheikh Muhammad Tim Humble, Abdurrahman Hassan, Abu Ibrahim. Those brothers, you learn from their websites and from their channels, and you'll be, inshallah ta'ala, on the right path. If my work requires making birthday cards occasionally, is that okay to do it? Wallahi, yani, if it's something that you do occasionally and you have no other choice, khair, inshallah. Yani, if obviously, in this day and time, if your job is overall halal, and there are aspects of the job that are haram, then there's nothing you can do about it. Inshallah, it's not an issue. Try to avoid it as much as possible. What about Daniel Hakika Chu? Daniel Hakika Chu, I can only speak about his criticism of Yaqeen, and I fully endorse his criticism of Yaqeen. The expositions and the information he's bringing out to the people and his study and analysis is something that I agree with and I endorse. As for the other aspects of his da'wah, the other aspects of his belief, I'm not aware of it and I'm not entitled to speak about it. So I cannot tell you that you can just follow him and listen to him blindly because I don't know what else he's saying. Okay, but I'm only familiar with him in the context of yaqeen. And from that perspective, I have no issue with him. In terms of other matters, Allah Ta'ala a'lam. طيب يا جماعة, it's already 4 o'clock and we need to call it a day. نعم, we will conclude with this. جزاكم الله خير. And forgive me if I didn't get to answer all your questions, but mashallah, tabarakallah, you guys are working hard to ask as many questions as possible. Gotta say, it's pretty darn lovely. طيب, سبحانك اللهم بحمدك, أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, أستغفرك أتوب إليك, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Thanks for watching this video. Subscribe and click on the notification bell. Like, comment, and share with friends and family.